Good evening, everyone. Dr. Talesra, Dr. Martin, and Ms. Phyllis. We are very, very happy to see you.
Welcome.
And all the dignitaries on this panel. Thanks for giving me an opportunity to speak on UN SDG 4 and quality education. And a vision on Earth Constitution. Basically, let me start sharing the presentation so that we can. Hope you can see the slide, right?
The slides are visible. Yeah, they are visible, sir. We can put them on the slideshow mode.
Yeah. Thanks. So today's discussion is on UN SDG 4, which is quality education and vision of Earth Constitution. As a deviation, you know, with your permission, I have taken a different approach in this. Basically, I have looked at as a management consultant on what is the quality education and what is the policy of UN and the UN agencies and how Earth Constitution looks at it, what is good and how we can improve on it, where to do, what to do, etc. So let's move on. The overview is like this. Let's look at the basics, then SDG 4, then the successes and challenges of SDG 4 as of now, as reported, and a review. So it is a comparative analysis along with the constitution which we have, which is otherwise known as Earth Constitution, and what is to be done in future. The first step, back to basics, it is everybody's knowledge that education is essential. You know, in global context, when we look at the world around, education is given different importance. In some of the underdeveloped countries, education is not at all a priority because they have to struggle for food, clothing, housing, etc. You know, education has taken a back seat. And in already developed countries, education is at a very high level. It is flourishing well. So education is essential. What it does, it supplements the development. In fact, it hastens the development. As a comparison, I can tell you, in our own villages, in Indian context, when we look at the villages, people may not be educated, but they have over a period of time developed on their own and have reached a level of consciousness. But for young people or for children, when we give them a systematic knowledge share, this development process gets hastened and their level of consciousness reaches a higher level. Now, when we look at the SDG 4 as enunciated on the UN and UN agencies, websites, platforms, material, etc., somewhere, you know, we find that it is limited to STEM. It is here that we need to concentrate a little and start thinking. Also, there is a need that education should build emotions and efficiency. Today, I, being a commerce man, basically into accounts, which only numbers, you know, for me, the numbers between 0 and 9 matter. I mean, I don't have any concern for human emotion in my work. But this doesn't work in practical situation because we are human beings, we are in human society. So obviously the technicality has to find an end place. With the changing trend of arts, crafts being given a go by, and people are concentrating more on computerization and artificial intelligence, this is becoming a real scary situation. Long, long back, when I was in US, I had seen a movie. You know, the title is The Miracle on the 34th Street, wherein, I think in the 1947 version of the movie, in fact, this is a movie which has been done again and again and again and again. But in the 1947 version, very nicely a thing is portrayed. It is said, emotion and imagination is a must in a person's life. So the Santa Claus character in that movie tries to imbibe emotion and intelligence and imagination in the mind and heart of the child, and also tries to convey the same thing to the parents of the child and society at large, which is a fantastic thing, you know. But today we don't find the same emotion efficiency anything in the society. You know, we are worried about computers, we are worried about money, and we are worried about technology, but we are not worried whether a man is hungry, whether a man has enough clothes to wear to cover from the natural vagaries. So this is given a big jolt. Education also should be for sustainable development on the earth. You know, this sustainable development for a commerce person is totally different as compared to a philosophic person, a person of philosophic background, because, you know, the way they look at it is totally different. You know, they will be looking at it from a different angle. But in effect, the sustainable development should be one standardized format. Now, Dr. Glenn always keeps mentioning it to us. In fact, last year we had it as a year of climate change and environmental protection. Lot of members of WCPA, they came forward with lot of initiatives. In fact, we honored some of them for their contribution to climate change and environmental protection. So education in a way should help in sustainable existence on earth. So we should preserve the natural resources which are available around us, and we should protect the environmental degradation and minimize it, and also ensure the climatic change doesn't happen at a much faster rate, because we already have it at a very bad situation. Education also should involve innovation. Already I said artificial intelligence and graphic mobile technology has already ravaged the education field. But innovation should be which is healthy and scientific one. And innovation should be part of education. Innovation and education are not separable. Education should help in finding solutions to global problems. In fact, it is at this stage, I wish to bring everybody's attention to one part. WCPA had started empowered by Earth Constitution, it started Global School on World Problems. You know, the object of the school is to identify, study the problems, and also find regional as well as global solutions. So education should help in minimizing the problems around, so that, you know, life becomes easy. And this requires a little questioning and concern for others. Questioning attitude and concern for others. You know, there is a very beautiful story in the Kathopanishad. A small young baby boy of maybe about 5-6 years old, when the boy sees his father doing wrong things, he gets annoyed. And as a consequence, he gets donated to the god of death, Yama. So words cannot be taken back. Father donated him to God. So he goes to hell. When he reaches the hell, the god is not in. He's gone out somewhere. So when the head of the family or head of the organization is not inside the house, it is a practice in our part of the world that we don't enter that house. So the child waits at the gate 3 days and three nights, and after that the Lord comes back and he sees this small young boy was kept waiting at the door for no fault of his. So he feels very sorry and he says, okay, here you are. I can give you three boons. Check what you want. You know, the best of the human intelligence is reflected in Kathopanishad, where it says, it gives out a question. In Sanskrit, it is said, Eyam prete vichikitsa manushyastityeke nayamastiti chaike. Imagine, he is only a small boy of 5-6 years, but he asks the question where, if I translate it into English, it says, people say that after death, a man is dead. Whereas some people say soul is immortal, he is alive, which is true. You know, the Lord of Death gets paranoid. I mean, he gets really jolted. He says, why do you want to answer? I mean, hear the answer for this. You ask me for money, you ask for wealth, you ask for anything else you want, I can give you. But why do you want to understand this? You know, the boy keeps asking. He says he wants to know. So the story starts from there. Why I mentioned this is, today's human civilization has somehow given a go-by to questioning attitude. Why? How? When? Where? I mean, half of the problems can be solved using this questioning attitude. But current education system doesn't allow a questioning attitude at all. In our part of the world, at least I have seen, you know, the students, they come, we teach, we give our lecture, they take the notes and go away and write something in the examination and they get credits and they get certified. Ultimately, the students' questions, they don't come out. So they don't get developed into a full-fledged personality. So education should help in asking questions. And another important point which I wish to bring in here is, education should help in building a skill-based society as we had in ancient times all over the world. At least in India, we knew every individual had a skill along with his family lineage, and he continued working on that front. Today, we have a difficulty here. We get school, we get schooling done, and we get certificate, but we don't have a skill. You know, till recently, because of the legacy we inherited, at least in India, we inherited a legacy of British culture, where we were employed as clerks or workers in office and factories. You know, we were given a separate training, but education learned all these days in schools and colleges is of no practical value. Ultimately, what I wish to say is, education should help in personality development and development of skill. Now, I saw this information on the website of UNDP. It mentions universal primary education. This phrase is really interesting. You know, it has three parts in it. First part, universal. Second, primary. And third is education. You know, each is very important and it needs to be understood in complete sense. The total, you know, some of the information given on the UNDP site also mentions total enrollment rate in developing regions reached 91% in 2015. Can you believe it? 91% enrollment in primary education. Worldwide number of children out of school has dropped almost by half. There has been a dramatic increase in literacy rates. Many more girls are in school than ever before. Here is a problem which I see as a management consultant. You know, we have been in all our policy decisions, we have been talking about the jargons, adjectives, and we are not qualifying any of our statements by virtue of numbers, except that first line where it says 91%. I don't know what is the total denominator out of which 90% has been taken, but this statement, many more girls are in school than ever before, is a piece of literature for me. Now, I cannot estimate the real quality education received by girl children in schools all over the world. Progress has also been tough in some developing regions due to high levels of poverty, armed conflicts, and emergencies. Interesting, you see, there are a few more lines which we should look at. The last line says, progress has been tough due to poverty, armed conflicts, and other emergencies. Keep that in mind. Progress has always been tough, yeah, sure. West Asia and North Africa ongoing armed conflict has seen increase in the number of children drop out of school. So on one side we have 91% and on the other side we have all these reasons which tells us that kids are not going to school. Kids are not getting into learning mode. Now you see the next part. Children from poorest households are up to 4 times more likely to be out of school. It says 4 times, which means 400 times. Children will be away from poorest households. So that means we have kept them poor and we have also kept them away from school. Interesting, you see, disparities between rural and urban areas also remain very high. In fact, what kind of development plan we have, we should check, because all these segregations, poor, rich, urban, rural, continent wise, color wise, race wise, you know, this criteria is really cumbersome and it is enigmatic anyway. Achieving inclusive quality education for all reaffirms the belief that education is one of the most powerful and proven vehicles for sustainable development. This is a very bold statement which UNDP has made. This goal ensures that all girls and boys complete free primary secondary schooling by 2030. This is a very good plan, but still, you know, there is no operational tactical, you know, strategy to ensure at least by 2030, that is another 10 years more or 9 years more, that all the boys and girls will complete the basic primary and secondary education all over the world. Now, when we look at the aim, which is mentioned on the UNDP site of this SDG 4, it says equal access and affordable vocational training to eliminate gender and wealth disparities and to achieve universal access to quality higher education. Wonderful. This idea is really good. But how is this plan to be implemented? How is this measured is to be seen. There are no statistics to that effect. There are a few challenges mentioned on the site. Enrollment in primary education in developing countries have reached 91%, which I already mentioned. But still, 57 million primary aged children remain out of school, more than half of them in sub-Saharan Africa. This is a real, you know, disturbing factor. In developing countries, one in four girls is not in school. Now, we have a huge spectrum of developing countries. Of them, if one-fourth of girl children have never visited school, then that's not a good situation to be in. About half of all out-of-school children of primary school age live in conflict-affected areas. Now, with the science and technology growing, and with the, all the technology and advancements in lifestyle situations improving, we have these conflict-affected areas which are really impacting the schooling in many places. We have seen this in about 7-8 states of India itself. Recently, I was in Guwahati, and when I went to a village there to see a project plan, I asked the school headmaster, when was the school closed? He said the school was closed long back because it's a trouble-torn place and, you know, students don't come. Now, actually, when you look at the exact statistics of out-of-school children, this number is really mind-boggling. So we should find a solution for this conflict between people and between regions, why this is affecting the sustainable development activity. 1 or 3 million youth worldwide lack basic literacy skills. This is what one line which really fascinated me, because it says 103 million youth worldwide lack basic literacy skills. Then what kind of education policy we have? And more than 60% of them are women. So that means we are keeping 60% of women out of basic literacy skills. 6 out of children and adolescents are not achieving a minimum level of proficiency in reading and math, because the concentration is on STEM, S-T-E-M, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Now, in fact, at this point, I wish to think how we have lagged behind by keeping non-scientific domains away from the area of study. You see, art, literature, painting, dancing, crafting, sports is also required for overall development of a personality. A person may be 100% scored in his engineering subject, but when we take an interview, he may not be able to comprehend what a question is in common parlance. So these are the real big challenges which the world is facing, according to UNDP. Now, when we look at it, what is needed? We need to redefine the definition of education. What is education? What is basic education? In fact, I was really interested in one of the projects which one of the professors from Bangalore was working on. In fact, Gandhiji made a very nice study, and he prescribed a very good mode of basic education for all. In fact, it was called Nayi Talim in those days. Maybe seniors like Dr. Talesra and others, they may know, but these days it is never heard of. Now, education needs to be redefined. Second, it needs to be boundaryless. When I say this, education should not have boundaries for knowledge share. We may have political and national boundaries, but education should be seamless. A person who is educated in India should be able to reach anywhere in the world and perform to the best of his skill, and the standard should be the same. In fact, a couple of decades ago, when I myself moved from India to US for the first time, and then when I walked into the corporate office of a big multinational company in US, I found there was a huge gap in our knowledge base. But why is it? Unfortunately, if you look at Indian education system, let us concentrate more on Indian education system as a comparison. I find it that we have degraded our standards by bringing down. And consequent upon which our levels, educational standards are not in sync with global standards. So there has to be a global policy on education. Does UN have a global policy on education? I'm not very clear on it. There are a lot of statements on education, but they don't specify what is the thumb rule on education, primary education, and how that needs to be implemented. Now, another factor. For any successful activity, there needs to be an organization. This is what we learn in commerce and commercial terminology. For education, also we need an organization. As an organization, has UN been very effective? I think since this UN, United Nations, has done many things very well, successfully well, but because of its own constitution and structure, it has not been able to deliver to the best possible extent because of lot of constraints created by its own structure. Now, do we have an action plan and support, infrastructure and financial support, more so in COVID-like situation? You see, when I was looking at the UN SDG, Sustainable Development Goal, SDG 4, I never found any reference to anywhere about a calamity, a catastrophe. Now, have we still not looked at it, though it is almost 1 year old in the world? I don't know. So the action plan needs to be revised. There needs to be an infrastructure and supportive mechanism for any such situation when education is under threat. For example, when the first case reported, we all closed our international travels. So the countries became cocoon, and even states became, districts became, everywhere we got ourselves cocoon. Now what happened? Schools and colleges got shut. People came out with an idea that, oh, online training can work miracle. Yes, we tried that. You know, in the first few months, we realized online is very good, no doubt, but it has implementational challenges. Because I can say this, the place where I am sitting and talking to you has a very good internet connect. 10 kilometers away in whichever direction, east, west, south, north, you will find a village where the phone doesn't work. If this is the situation in the heart of the city like a Bangalore, then what will happen in rural places and what will happen in Africa, Ghana, and other places? I don't know. So mere statement will not help, but there has to be a concrete action plan, and necessary infrastructure to meet contingencies. Now, there has to be a review and control mechanism and managed by professionals. Now, let's move on. All the while now, we spoke about very briefly on what is the success part, what is the challenge which UN and UN agencies are facing. Now we have seen how the situation is. Now let us come back to the Earth Constitution. Before I jump into Earth Constitution, let me give you a quick backdrop to the Earth Constitution. When UN got formed, many of us, we realized that it is going to be a very successful journey. But many intellectuals very soon found out that this is not going to happen because of the very structure of UN. So they started thinking the corrective step. So people thought of corrective steps, and corrective steps have been thought, and ultimately we have passed through 75 years when recently UN celebrated 75 years of its existence. Very nice. But now, what is required? The world requires an Earth Constitution, like any other country having its own constitution at the helm of its affairs. The world also requires an Earth Constitution because beyond the boundaries, we have no control. So beyond the boundaries, within the Earth's periphery, we need to have a successful, cohesive and better living condition. So obviously we need some kind of governing system. The UN was planned to be one. UN was originally planned to be a global government, but it didn't take off from the place where it started. And in fact, very recently, thanks to Dr. Glenn and team there, and thanks to some of the intelligent people from US and Brussels, we found out a fact that people who visited from India in 1945 to sign the treaty on behalf of Indian government, they made a condition. They put in a condition saying that veto should not be there. Now, but all the developed countries, they insisted that, okay, veto has to be there for whatever reason. When it became almost impossible to get away the veto, people who signed on behalf of India, they made a concession subject to a condition. They said, okay, here is veto. You know, you look at it for 10 years and veto should be away after 10 years. Now, it is almost 75 years since inception. Even if you assume 10 years, it is almost 65 years now. For 65 years, we have lived with a UN which had a review clause in it, built in its own charter under Article 109, which insisted that charter should be reviewed and changes should be made and it should be revisited. But it has not happened. So we can look at how successful is UN from that perspective. Now let us look at what is there in the Earth Constitution. Very interestingly, many of you may have a copy of the Earth Constitution, and to brief everyone, I have taken the addresses of many people whom I may intend to send a copy of Earth Constitution immediately. Now we are working on some organizational issue. Once that gets done, you know, I will ensure that many of you get a copy. And I'll also send you the email link so that you can use it on a digital platform. You can read it on your computer. The Earth Constitution has this vision. You know, the preamble part, it says, it recognizes that we are at a turning point. You know, quite practically, Dr. Glenn Martin says that we are sitting on the cusp of a catastrophe. That is true. So what second factor is interdependence of people. Earth Constitution understands and realizes interdependence of people. People in India need people in US, and people in Africa need people in Canada, people in Japan need people in Australia. So we are all interdependent. We are surviving on different landfills, but ultimately we are one human family. So this interdependence should not become a factor of hindrance for this global governance. In the current system, if you see, for education, if somebody has to go out of India or if somebody has to come into India, he or she faces a lot of challenges, at least for education. Now, I think somewhere this is a very nice point, which I realized in Earth Constitution, that we have a clause which recognizes interdependence of people. And it also recognizes abuse of science and technology. And it recognizes our obligation to posterity. But if you look at the current situation, the societal situation, I don't think we are even looking at posterity. We have been cutting millions and millions of trees and releasing lot of emissions into the environment. And education, what we have done, we haven't done anything other than giving grace marks and giving certificates. And you don't know how many fake certificates are there in the market. But anyway, now coming back to the point, our obligation to posterity is very important. We have lived our life, so we should leave a clean, healthy, better world for the future generations. So we have to have a clean, clear policy on education also. Now, Earth Constitution recognizes humanity as one family, and ultimately it says we need a democratic world government, for which we are all working on. Now, Earth Constitution in its Article 1 has very broad functions and looks at holistic approach, which Dr. Glenn Martin has in his previous lecture brought out wonderfully on all those functions, how they can be integrated into a holistic system. Now, this holistic approach covers education also in a way which we will look at it in the coming slides. Article 4.12 defines standards and promote the worldwide improvement in many areas. So standards are to be fixed and promote improvement. So this has to work like a corporate office, where we will have standards, tasks, dates, deadlines, turnaround times, and whether what has been achieved or not, why it is achieved, why it is not achieved. You know, we need to do quick review on this, at least in education part. Now, this is to be done. I'm not sure if the current system is really catering to this. Now, Article 13.4, which is part of the directive principles and our Earth Constitution, gives this exhaustive line. It says, free and adequate public education. Mark these words, free and adequate public education available to everyone, extending up to pre-university level. Equal opportunities for elementary and higher education for all persons. Equal opportunity for continued education for all persons throughout life. See, this is the best part which I liked in the Earth Constitution. Equal opportunity for continued education for all persons throughout life. The right of any person or parent to choose a private educational education at any time. Now, summarily, what it says is the education, primary education has to be for everyone. It should be free up to pre-university level, and there should be equal opportunities. Now, if you look at the current situation in India, you know, a person having a child will be half burdened because of the donations he has to pay at a pre-nursery. pre-kindergarten, not even kindergarten, pre-kindergarten, baby nursery, school, you know, they are charging heavily, and more so post-COVID situation, they are charging not only online fees, offline fees, and the governments have not been able to help anybody. And you know, I go teach in management schools in Bangalore. I find many students not attending the classes. When I check with them, they say their parents have raised their hands up saying, no, we cannot pay all the fees now in the current situation. So we cannot afford any cost at this stage. So, you know, we cannot send you to the college. If this is the situation we are in, then what will happen? Now, that's a real scary part. Let's look at the Article 13.12. Article 13.12 ensures each child the right to full realization of his or her potential. So there is no discrimination. There is no black or white. There is no rich or poor. There is no, any kind of discrimination here. So this is a very free and very clear definition of what the equality means. Now, we saw what are the provisions of Earth Constitution. You know, under the umbrella of Earth Constitution, WCPA has been passing model legislative acts, world legislative acts. There are about 67 as of now. The details can be shared on the website. Now, some of them very relevant to education I have picked up. Legislative Act 4. It says Act for inaugurating the world university system with a graduate school of world problems. The first session of Provisional World Parliament meeting held in September 1982. It says, does hereby grant the charter for a graduate school of world problems as a first part of world university system. This is really very interesting. Now, the purposes for which graduate school on world problems is started is very clear here. Here, what we are saying is to prepare individuals for a peaceful solution and to prepare competent personnel, to prepare individuals to complete their professional qualification, to prepare individuals to become competent global statesmen and stateswomen. So it looks at both. So there is no gender discrimination here. Who will be particularly well qualified to hold public office? This is very interesting. And to provide central campus for studies, research, training, and other activities and appropriate to the above defined purposes with schools at branch campuses later. So, I mean, this idea of GSWP further, it very clearly says to attract and assemble together both faculty and students who are qualified and committed to the studies, research, preparations, and activities necessary for accomplishing the above purposes. So it looks at talent acquisition, talent pooling, to provide libraries, etc., to assemble current information and studies about world problems. So this is all about the GSWP, which currently the Earth Constitution provides, can be a model for future education policy of the world. Now, let us move on and talk about World Parliament University, which I have understood as it is. It is meant for higher education and research and non-conventional domains. You know, we have enough universities which teach graduate programs, but here, you know, we will be concentrating more on non-conventional domains, focus more on experiential learning, build capacity, and help in acquisition of talent, and create a global talent base so that this talent can be deployed anywhere on need. So this World Parliament University initiative is still going on now. We have filed papers with the government, and we'll be taking up further and we'll let you know the details soon. Now there is another aspect which comes under our constitution is WCPA Global Schools. Visa research, visa university, and we are now seeing schools also. So it will be a supplementary to current system. We are not saying that current system will be replaced, but it can slowly improve the current system and replace the existing system over a period of time. Innovative learning methods, human integration, and basically problem solving approach. These are what envisaged in global schools. So at this stage, we saw how the act, the World Legislative Act, provides for these, and Earth Constitution in addition to this provides another dimension to the growth and to education. You see, under Article 7.3, the world government will have 28 departments, world administration departments. As of now, you see, even if you look at UN sustainable goals, we have 17 there. So here, Earth Constitution looks at 28, so another 11 more. When you look at the list, most important of them is basically there is a place for education, 736. So there is a place for education, but in addition to that, you look at all the other gamuts of public life, disarmament and prevention, population, environment, water, health, nutrition, habitat and settlement, which is very important. Today we are talking in cities and villages, development of slums. Slums are leading to poverty, and poverty ultimately leads children to drop away from schools. So, I mean, Earth Constitution has a beautiful picture and plan, which when implemented will definitely lead to sustainable existence on Earth. You see labor and income, economic and social development, commerce and industry, human rights, distributive justice, exterior relations, foreign service, democratic procedures. Very important. See, what is very interesting and very important in Earth Constitution is emphasis on democratic procedures. WCPA firmly believes in democratic procedures, and we as global citizens, we believe in democratic world procedures. So obviously the global governance system also should be governed by democratic world, democratic procedures. But when you look at the practical situation, it is not so. As I already mentioned, world's second populous country and the largest democracy of the world, India, doesn't have a permanent sitting on UN. Now, we have been given every once in 10 years, they give us a 2-year term. You know, we go sit there and walk out like a merry-go-round. And ultimately, what kind of a democratic procedure is this? So, in effect, there should be a proper democratic procedure, and that should be completely implemented. Summarily, I can say, UN idea is really good, but it is not very effective because of its own structural, constitutional problems. So people have tried revising it, but they have not been effective. So there is no way that we can correct this system, which is not got corrected for the last 8 decades. So obviously we need a new system under Earth Constitution. See, all that we are saying is, UN has to come under the umbrella of a constitution. It cannot depend on a charter. Charter is a matter of convenience, whereas a constitution is a matter of legally binding covenants. Now, Next thing we need is Kaizen technology. It should be applied in education. So there should be a continuous review, process review, upgradation, changes. And this has to happen seamlessly all over the world. And world needs a policy and not a statement. This is my personal view, and I see that the current UN emphasis on education, quality education, is only a statement, and it's a good intent. I don't question their integrity, but it is a good statement, good intent. But a good statement and good intent may not be effectively implemented. So there has to be a governing policy, and there has to be a procedure for implementation. Action plan should be in place, and it should work like a corporate project. Because, you know, everything is governed by time and money. It cannot be just going on dragging like this. And more so, all the systems and processes should be people-centric and not rule-centric. There should be test models built. In fact, you know, what are these test models? Under Earth Constitution, we have already planned for a university. That is a test model. And we all should work together to bring in a good global education policy and a good global education model. We should implement it and see in our own place first. And then, you know, in that process, we can see what are the stumbling blocks, how we can improve on them, what are the changes that we need. You know, it's an iterative process. So obviously, test models need to be built. Under Earth Constitution, already WPU and global schools have already begun, in the sense that the idea has begun and work is going on. Now, ultimately, you know, what is very important is education is not a job and teacher is not a worker. This is my statement, mainly because people think today that education is a job, a kind of a job. A fellow who is selling tires, can he become a teacher someday? Or a person who is into carpentry, can he become a teacher unless he is teaching carpentry? Now, people should have skill-based vocations. You know, because of this economic disruptions, people are moving from one job to other, and you know, education also has seen a lot of dilution in its standards, and this needs to be kept up. And secondly, teacher should not be treated like a worker. He is a professional. He is a scientist. You know, he is going to groom the future world civilization. Obviously, he needs to have all the skill, all the professional expertise that is required for this. So, net-net, the current situation under UN SDG 4 is very attractive, but the implementation part is lacking. So, we should find a way to implement it better. This is my submission. So, I thank you for giving me an opportunity to make this presentation. I stop sharing the slides now. If you have questions, I can take them.